Good morning. Welcome to Lowcountry Community Church. I'm Jason Best, the executive pastor here. I want to thank you for spending part of your weekend here at LCC. Service will be starting soon, so as you're finding your seat, please help make room for everyone by scooting towards the center of your row. Also, please take a second to silence your cell phones, but parents, keep your phones handy so the children's ministry can text you if they need to get a hold of you. We love it when you share your Sunday experience online, so make sure you tag us when you post your pictures. Now, if you haven't already, please find your seat. It's going to be a great day.
That you've decided to join us today. I'm Jordan, one of the pastors on staff. And this morning, we come together to sing and lift up the name of Jesus, a God who is at work in us and around us. And so today, we invite you to sing with us, to participate with us, to lift our voice together as the church. So let's sing.
I give you glory for
name is Jason. I'm the executive pastor. I want to welcome you to LCC. We're so glad that y'all are here worshiping with us today. If this is one of your first times here, we want you to know that you're among friends. We also would like for you to know we've got a gift for you just for being our guest here today. All you need to do is pull out your phone and text the word HEYLCC, that's all one word, to the number 99000. Then on your way out today, stop by our blue welcome tent outside, and the folks there will be expecting you, and they'll have one of those gifts set aside just for you. Well, happy 2019. We're excited to be kicking off a brand new year with a brand new four-part message series. Pastor Jeff, all this month, will be teaching on hope for the new year. Well, it is that time of the year when many of us make a list of New Year's resolutions, and one of the things that's usually top on most people's list is money, getting their finances in order. Unfortunately, failed attempts at getting their money in order sometimes tops that list of New Year's resolution fails. We want to help you with all that, though. We've got a brand new session of Financial Peace University, Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University, starting on Monday, January 14th at 6:30 p.m. It will run for 9 consecutive Monday evenings, and it will change your financial life. So if you'd like more information on that class, you'd like to get signed up, and if you'd like to find out more about all the other classes that will be beginning in February, you can pull out your phone and text the word LCC classes to that same 99000. Well, one other thing that usually makes people's list of resolutions is spending more time with friends. So for all the ladies in the audience, we've got a great opportunity for you to get together with some old friends and hopefully make some new ones by being a part of our upcoming LCC Women's Prayer Breakfast on Saturday, January 12th at 10 a.m. In addition to enjoying some food and fun and fellowship together, those ladies will specifically be praying for our upcoming spring women's event taking place March 1st. We're bringing in a nationally known author and speaker. Her name is Nicole Eunice, and she'll be teaching from her book, The Struggle is Real. So ladies, if you'd like to find out about that event, get signed up for the breakfast, pull out your phone and text the word LCC Women to that same 99000. Now, in just a couple of minutes, we're going to be receiving our offering. But first, we've got one more new thing to celebrate, and that's an addition to our elder board, and his name is Kevin Ferrugio. Now, Kevin and his wife, Marcy, are certainly not new to our church. They've been here and actively serving since 2002. So I'm going to invite them to come out, along with Pastor Jeff and the other elders, and together, we're going to install Kevin as an elder here at LCC.
Good morning, everybody. This is always an exciting time for us to be able to acknowledge people that God has called to various ministries in our church. And as Jason just said, Kevin and Marcy have been here for a long time and came to know Christ at our church. I remember very well, it was an Easter Sunday. What year was that? 2002. And as you've seen us do here many, many times, lead in a prayer. And I said, if you've prayed that prayer with me, would you indicate it by raising your hand? And I looked straight in the back there. They were sitting right next to the projector stand because we were in the cafetorium or gymnasium or whatever they call it over there at McCracken Middle School. And both of them, side by side, raised their hands up and came to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior that day. And God has done some just pretty neat stuff in the years between now and then, and now Kevin serving as one of our elders. Kevin has been tested doctrinally, and I'm proud to say came through with flying colors, and we've examined his life, and he's gone before, his name went before you a few weeks ago as a membership, a church. If you're a member here, you received a letter from us, and so it's our privilege today to pray along with some of the other elders here to lay hands on them and install Kevin as an elder at Lowcountry. So I'm going to ask you as we pray if you'll join us in standing up, and I'm going to ask Kevin a question. I'm going to ask you a question, and then I'm going to lead us in prayer. Kevin, do you now accept your office as a sacred and solemn trust from the Lord Jesus Christ, promising him and this church to fulfill its responsibilities and ministries as indicated above to the best of your ability? Church, will you strive with God's help to be examples of Christ in the middle of those that he has set before you as leaders? Will you support Kevin and these other elders and your pastors? Will you continue to pray? And specifically now, as Kevin's a new elder, will you pray for him? Will you support him? Will you just come alongside of him as one of our leaders over us? If you agree with that, would you say I do?
I do.
Amen. Will you join us in prayer? Let's pray together. Our Father and our God, thank you so much for the call that you've had on Kevin's life to bring him to this point, and for he and Marcy and their children. This time in their lives is very special, and it's a solemn responsibility that Kevin undertakes, but we know that he has not done this lightly, nor have we. And this is something that we believe you have brought about, and you have called him to this service, this ministry. I pray that you would protect him, watch over him. May they both and the whole Ferrugio family continue to love you, Lord Jesus Christ, with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and their neighbors as themselves. And we as a church commit ourselves again to you, to be a light in this community, to support our elders as they lead us and guide us. Thank you for establishing this office according to 1 Timothy and Titus. And Lord, we just commit Kevin now as an elder in his ministry over these ensuing years. We pray all these things through Jesus' name. And also, as we now move on to give to you in worship by our tithes and our finances, Lord, would you take what we give you now and use them to advance the cause of Jesus, both here and around the world. We pray these things, Jesus, in your name. And God's people said, amen. Please remain standing as we sing.
Check out the screens.
That song, man, I love everything about that song. Good morning again. My name is Jeff Cranston, and I'm the lead pastor here at LowCountry. So glad that you're here with us, here in the room, watching online, as hundreds do every week, out in the concourse, wherever you are. So glad that you are here. Let me just take a second and thank you for your prayers, your support, the fact that you invited folks for serving one of the five Christmas Eve services. It seems so long ago now, Christmas Eve, but if you haven't heard, we had approximately 4,300 people that were part of those services, about 1,000 more than last year. How do those things happen? I don't know. But well, yeah, God, yeah, Jesus, so, yeah. But more than that, 866 people prayed to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Every time I looked up, you know, if you were here, I asked people to hold their candle up if they prayed with me. There were a couple services I really wondered if there were any Christians at all in the service. There were so many that went up, and just completely, I don't have a category for that. I don't know quite what to do with that. At Easter time, we saw 495, and I remember driving home on Easter Sunday after, I don't know, we did four or five services then too, I think, and I'd never seen anything like that in my life in terms of a response to the gospel. And I remember driving home thinking, and I'll probably never see anything like that again. And God goes, and did above and beyond. So pray for those new believers. Many are don't live here, visiting, or you know how people do over the holidays. But if you're one of those folks, if you're one of those people, help us help you by getting in one of our new believers classes. We offer them quite frequently. Just go online or just ask anybody at one of the info islands. But thank you for giving. We're going to give a financial update to you next Sunday, I think, on the, you know, we were trying to end the year strong, and we did, and I want to bring you up to speed with that. But thank you for praying and giving and ministering and inviting, because we saw lives just change. The stories that I've heard already just give you God bumps. They're not goosebumps, they're God bumps. Or make you weep. So anyway, let me begin our time today by sharing a story with you. Maybe you'll remember this if you studied literature in high school or college. Homer's Odyssey. Anybody remember that? Homer's Odyssey. The main character, Odysseus, and his men had been out in their ships, tossed about, wildly thrown off course, and spent years sailing from island to island, facing obstacle after obstacle, all in their quest to make it back home and see their loved ones. And one of the stops early in the journey was on it was referred to as the Island of the Lotus Eaters. And when Odysseus dropped anchor, he was unaware that this island was a trap. Anyone who arrived and ate the fruit of the lotus plant that covered the island never wanted to leave. All they wanted to do, do you remember? Just sit in the sun and relax. It sounds like a pretty good life. Well, they dropped anchor and he was unaware of that, and some of his crew had gone on shore and they didn't come back. And so Odysseus sent scouts to explore the island and they never came back either. And then he sent more scouts to scout out the scouts, but they didn't return. Then Odysseus went out with more scouts to scout out the second scouts who had been sent to scout out the first scouts in the first place. And what he found absolutely astonished him. All of his soldiers sitting around, all of them with their feet propped up, lazing around in the sun. None of them wanted to leave because they had eaten the fruit. And Homer writes this: any crewman who ate the lotus, the honey-sweet fruit, lost all desire to send a message back, much less return. Their only wish to linger there with the lotus eaters, grazing on lotus, all memory of the journey home dissolved forever. Lost all desire. All memory of the journey home dissolved forever. Had they not seen yet the emotional videos on YouTube of men and women in the armed forces, our armed forces, surprising their spouses and kids when they return home from being deployed overseas? Have you seen these videos? I'll tell you, I don't weep at these. I have tears streaming down my face every time I watch one of those things. How could it be possible that all memory of the journey home dissolved forever? These were men who had spent, to this point, 10 years approximately away from their homes and their spouses and their children, their homeland. And Homer tells us that Odysseus knew he had to act fast or he would lose his men for good. So recounting firsthand the drastic measures it took to recover his men, Odysseus says this: I brought them back to the hollow ships in streaming tears. I forced them, hauled them under the rowing benches, lashed them fast, and shouted out commands to my other steady comrades. Quick, no time to lose, embark in the racing ships so none could eat the lotus and forget the voyage home. I want to make sure you see this scene in your mind. These battle-hardened warriors forcibly strapped to the bottom of the ship to keep them from diving overboard and swimming back to the island just so they could sit in the sun all day. That was the power of the lotus plant. Once you fell under its hypnotic spell, you can't free yourself from its power. All help has to come from the outside. What seems odd to me at times about Christians living the Christian life is how often we find ourselves in situations we know we need to change, but we don't, because in the words of Homer, we have lost all desire. We've grown content, but not in the sense that we've assessed where we are and decided we're not going to change because we're going to focus on other priorities. It's just the sense that we simply have stopped caring, and we have resigned ourselves to the fact that this is the mess I find myself in, and I can't muster the motivation to find my way out. That's not depression, although depression will sometimes mask this, but the condition for many, many, many of us is anxiety and fear over what's coming next in our lives. Did you have any catch in your spirit? Have you had any thoughts running through your mind when 12 o'clock and 1 second this past week, when it became January 1st, 2019? Did you have any thoughts running through your mind? I wonder what this year will hold and it just brought anxiety into you. Do you worry about what this year holds? Well, 2018 couldn't get any worse. 2019 has to be better. And then you think, or does it? You know, and we do this to ourselves. Our age has been called the age of anxiety. The plaintive cry of our society is summed up, I think, by John Margolis, who wrote in the Chicago Tribune once. He said, "I have seen the future and it doesn't work." Perhaps one of the greatest philosophers you and I have ever read is Charlie Brown. And Charlie said, "I have a new philosophy of life. I am going to begin dreading only one day at a time." Is that how God wants us to look at our lives, really? To assume this deterministic, fatalistic, woe is me, nothing will ever be good again, anxiety-ridden, angst-filled kind of a lifestyle. Is that what Jesus had in mind when he said that we will live a life of full abundance? And the answer obviously is what? No. And here's why. Here's why. Let's join Jesus and his disciples in the upper room. And we're going to be in John 13 and 14 all the month of January. And we're just going to go through it and see what Jesus has to say about things. Next week, we're just going to plant on John 14, 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And we're going to look at the implications of what that means for our lives. But here we are, the disciples in the upper room. And the disciples, we find them in the process of becoming extremely anxious. Their future doesn't look promising. They're worried. They're concerned. So if you have a Bible, or whatever you're looking at the Bible on, John chapter 13, the latter part of verse 21, and we'll read on through verse 29. Jesus is speaking and says, "Truly, truly, I say to you that one of you will betray me." The disciples began looking at one another, at a loss to know of which one he was speaking. There was, reclining on Jesus' bosom, one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. So, and it's, we're reading the Gospel of John. John's talking about himself there. He's just leaning up against Jesus. So Simon Peter gestured to John, and said, "Tell us who it is of whom he is speaking." He, that's John, leaning back on Jesus' breast, said to him, "Lord, who is it?" So Peter thought John knew. John doesn't know. "Lord, who is it?" Jesus then answered, "That is the one for whom I shall dip the morsel and give it to him." So when he had dipped the morsel, he took and gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. After the morsel, this is one of the most chilling verses in the Bible. After the morsel, Satan then entered into him. Therefore, Jesus said to him, "What you do, do quickly." Now, no one of those reclining at the table knew for what purpose he had said this to him. For some were supposing, because Judas had the money box, that Jesus was saying to him, "Buy the things we have need of for the feast," or else that he should give something to the poor. We're entering into the last season of Jesus' life here. And I'm doing this in this month with us because I know Christmas was just a couple weeks ago, but Easter's not that far away. And it's good to think again on these things. We got to understand why the disciples were troubled. Well, first, Jesus had announced that one of them would be a traitor. The other gospel accounts record their reaction as shock. They ask in Matthew 26, all a bunch of, "Surely not I, Lord. Surely not I. It's not me." Secondly, Jesus warned Peter later on in chapter 13, "You're going to deny me three times." We'll look at that closely more, but for now, Peter said to him, "Lord, why can I not follow you right now? I will lay down my life for you." Jesus answered, "Will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, a rooster will not crow until you deny me three times." And just as Peter is beginning to talk like a hero, Jesus announced that he would be a casualty of fear. It said when the Civil War broke out, one Union volunteer light infantry company to the man decided to disband and go into hiding rather than risk their own deaths in war. Well, the war was fought, the war was over, the Union was victorious, and it came time for this light infantry company to return home. Now, they'd never fought in a battle. They'd gone into hiding their entire time. They all got together and they had a meal and they decided, let's propose a toast to ourselves before we go home. And the toast has become legendary. And someone, as they raised their glasses, said about of themselves, invincible in peacetime, invisible in wartime. And Jesus seems to infer something along those lines regarding Peter. His prediction of, Peter, you're going to deny me, it not only shocked Peter, it shocked the other disciples. I mean, Peter denied the Lord. Peter had been the only one willing to risk his neck by getting out of the boat and walking on the water toward Jesus. It was Peter who had become one of Jesus' closest confidants. If brave, strong Peter will deny Jesus, what will the others do? The third reason they were very nervous about what Jesus was telling them here, and by far the most devastating fact, I think, was that Jesus notified the disciples, I'm going to leave you. In John 13 and 33, he says these words, little children, now he's talking to the disciples, little children, I am with you a little while longer. You will seek me. And as I said to the Jews, now I say also to you, where I am going, you cannot come. Man, that just struck fear into their hearts. The Lord used these words, little children, in addressing them. And it's the only time Jesus ever used that term to talk to the disciples. It's an intimate, very tender term, often used in the Grecian culture at that time, that a mother would use to her children. Why in that moment did he speak so tenderly toward them? Why did he refer to them as precious little children? Because he was watching them behave and respond like little children do, with confusion and insecurity and fear. And he's telling them he's going to leave them. And then, like children, they begin to just pepper him with questions. If you've had a little person in your house, they will ask you a million questions. And most of them begin with what word? Why? Why? And most of my answers to my grandchildren and my children begin with, I don't know. I have no idea. Why? Chapter 13, verse 36. Lord, where are you going? Verse 37. Lord, why can I not follow you right now? Chapter 14, verse 5. Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where you are going. How do we know the way? Verse 8 is in the form of a request from Philip. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it's enough for us. Questions, questions, questions. Do you have questions of your own for God? And do you know what I think about you and me? I think most of our questions to God also begin with why. Why this, Lord? Why that? Why not that? Why not this? The disciples saw things working out a whole lot differently than they thought. And now they're surrounded by doubts and fears, and their hope is dissipating. This teaching series is all about new hope in a new year. But their hope is drying up. It's dissipating. It's dust in the wind. Those of you who lived through the 70s, stop thinking about Kansas right now. Others of you have no idea what I'm talking about. But Jesus has dealt the ultimate. I mean, this is rough from Jesus. I mean, if you and I are in a place, I'm going to leave and you can't come with me. How else can you explain the first phrase of chapter 14? Jesus sees their confusion, their hope dissipating, their fear, their doubts, and Jesus says, do not let your heart be troubled. Don't let your heart be troubled. See, as far as the disciples could see, they're headed into a terrible storm. And chapter 14 really is a chapter of solutions. It's a chapter that answers a lot of the questions, but the basic question of the disciples is answered. Just what will happen when Jesus leaves? They're looking for hope of some sort. And so are we. And friends, the answer and basis for real hope in our lives is founded upon the fact that Jesus Christ is completely trustworthy. Jesus Christ is completely trustworthy. Do not let your heart be troubled. Another way to translate that could be, stop letting your heart be troubled. The word trouble in the Greek language means distressed, anguished, in turmoil. And some of you in here, concourse, online, right now, your heart, that just described your heart. Troubled, anguish, in turmoil, distress, that's your life. And Jesus says, don't let your heart get that way. Don't let it be that way. Stop allowing it to be that way. And we think what? Oh, if it were only that easy. It doesn't do you any good to tell a child that's crying, stop crying, without giving them a good reason why they need to stop crying. The first part of Jesus addressing all of this is a command. Do not let your heart be troubled. It's a command from him to you and me. And actually, the way this verse is written in the Greek language, the next two phrases are in what's called the imperative or the first imperative. It means there should be exclamation points behind them. So I'll read it like that. Jesus says in a command, don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. Exclamation point. Believe in God and believe also in me. That's how you don't let your heart be troubled. Now, this belief and this continuing belief has nothing to do with salvation. Jesus is not encouraging his followers to just hold on in order that you hope you'll make it to the shores of heaven. He's encouraging us to hold on so that you'll make it through the storms of life. He seems to be suggesting it will be much harder to keep on believing in him. See, we trust him for our eternal security. We trust him for our salvation. And somehow that is not, sometimes it's just not hard to make that step. For other people it is, but for many, no, I trust him with that. I trust him for heaven, for all of eternity. But man, am I having trouble trusting him to live out this vapor called life right now. The disciples are about to see him arrested, dragged off to court, condemned by the rulers, nailed to a cross, jeered by a mob, having a crown of thorns placed on his head, having a spear stuck in his side, listening to him say seven statements from the cross. And by the way, the weeks leading up, the 7 weeks leading up to Palm Sunday, we're going to look at each one of those statements in February and in March and into April. In other words, it's like you believe in God whom you've never seen. Now keep trusting me, Jesus is saying, even though you don't understand what you're about to see. Let me say that again. You believe in God whom you've never seen. And Jesus is saying, keep trusting me, even though you don't understand what you're about to see. Keep trusting me, even though you don't understand what you are going through right now. Keep trusting me, even though it may not be making sense. Keep trusting me, even though your hope is waning. Keep trusting me through the doubt, through the anxiety, through the fear, through 2019. Keep trusting me. The next few verses of John 14 have been considered through the ages to be the most comforting words in all of Scripture. And as I said earlier, we live in an anxiety-ridden age. Millions of calls annually are made to dial a horoscope lines. People are looking for answers, and the truth is, every human heart craves an answer about tomorrow. The only difference is where people look for the answer. And the only one, though, who has the answers is God. This passage, the only way that this passage, do not let your heart be troubled, believe in God, believe also in me, the only way that will ever bring you hope, the only way those words will ever heal your heart is that if you believe that Jesus Christ is completely trustworthy. Second principle, the passage reminds the child of God that our future home in heaven is a promised reality. I love this part of my time with you because I get to talk about heaven. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. A Gallup poll released some interesting information. It revealed that 78% of Americans believe in a place like heaven or believe in heaven, and 88% of Americans felt they have a good to excellent chance of going there. Yeah, I think I'm going to make it. May I just get real with you for a moment? If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're not going to make it. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you don't have a good to excellent chance. You have a 100%, it's not even a chance. It's 100% guaranteed that you are going to spend eternity in heaven with God because of what Jesus has done on the cross and the fact that God raised him from the dead. Chance. Chance. You talk to people about heaven, you get a variety of impressions. I think children have the best ones. Little Eric said it's a place where there's a lot of money lying around. Scott said, heaven's up in the sky and you can look down at circuses for free if you want to, except you have to ask God for permission first. David said, heaven is kind of big and you sit around playing harps. I don't know how to play a harp, but I suppose I'll have to take some dumb harp lessons pretty soon. One little girl, this is deep. She said, heaven will be the happiest part of my dead life. There's misconceptions about heaven. Number one, heaven's filled with huge mansions, right? Heaven's just filled with huge mansions. Where do we get that concept from? It's because the New American Standard that I'm reading from, in my Father's house are many dwelling places. The King James Version said, in my Father's house are many mansions. And this has sparked many imaginations to think in the same category of what I would like to live in if I won the Mega Millions lottery. This is the mansion I have in my mind. Gospel songs, the gospel songs I grew up on don't help much either. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we'll never more wander but walk on streets that are paved with gold. Truth is, many of us have grown up thinking heaven is this incredible gated community. And we think when we get there, some angelic real estate agent will say, now, if you go down that golden street and turn left at the first intersection, then go down three more blocks and then hang a right, you'll see your mansion on the right. It'll be the second one on the right, just in front of the lake. He's talking about rooms, places of abode. Get the mansion concept out of your mind. In Christ's day, when a son married, the father would add a wing. And by wing, I don't mean a wing like we would add a wing. I mean a room or two. The father would add that on to his house for his son. And then if another son got married, they would add another wing on the house. And then they would have a patio of sorts in the middle of it all, and that's where the family would congregate. The Amish do this still today. See, if you're going to live in a mansion, it's going to have you miles away from the father. And what Jesus is saying is, no. You're coming in under my roof. I've got a place of abode for you with me. I've got a dwelling place. You're not going to be 100,000 miles away. You're going to be living with me under the same roof. That's the concept of heaven. The proper picture, you as the bride to his son who married you, the church, you're living under the same roof. A wing has been added for you. Misconception number two is that heaven's under construction. For I go to prepare a place for you. And many have unfortunately concluded that in some way Jesus has a hammer and blueprints and is in the process of building the new city where everyone's home is currently under construction. And furthermore, the size of your new room or your mansion in the bad theology is dependent upon how much you send on ahead. What's Jesus talking about? One of the Greek words that's used to describe Jesus elsewhere and is used in John 14, 2 is the Greek word prodamos, prodamos. And it's most often translated forerunner, not a Toyota, F-O-R-E, forerunner. We read in Hebrews, this hope we have as an anchor of the soul, a hope for sure and steadfast, and one which enters within the veil, where Jesus has entered as a forerunner for us. Back in the day, in the Appalachian coal mines, it was one man's job to go down in the mines every morning, alone, before any other miners entered, to check to make sure the mines were safe and there wasn't the presence of methane gas. Now, back in the day of an open flame, this was a very dangerous job. He would check for that, and then he would come back up, and he would tell the assembled miners at the mouth of the cave, it's safe for you to enter. He was a forerunner. And that way, Jesus is going to prepare heaven for his children. He's going before, he has gone before all of us. He has already climbed through the dark tunnels of death and hell. He has ripped the stinger out of death and removed our obligation to hell. He has made a clear path for us from earth to heaven. Our home in heaven is a promised reality. It is real. It is a true and worthy destination for the children of God because Jesus has made it that way. And lastly, as I close, our future is guaranteed permanently. If I go and prepare a place for you, verse 3, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am there, you may be also. If Jesus Christ is infinite God, which he is, totally trustworthy and reliable, and he lives forever, which he does, and our future is with him, then our future is, according to his own words, forever secure. Your future as a child of God is guaranteed permanently. Whether you're weak or strong, whether you are of little faith or great faith, whether you are an immature believer or a mature believer, whether you have been a Christian for decades or you have just become a follower of Jesus, you are on your way home. A hymn writer said, just think of stepping on shore and finding it heaven, of taking hold of a hand and finding it God's, of breathing new air and finding it celestial, of waking up in glory and finding it home. There will come a day when all of your questions will have answers, all of your fears will be put to rest, all your tears will be wiped dry, but it won't all completely happen here. So in the meantime, you want to find hope. Remember, Jesus is completely trustworthy regardless of what you see happening around you. Rejoice in the meantime that you have a home in heaven which is prepared and waiting, and that your future for eternity is permanently guaranteed. Let's pray together. Jesus, this is awesome. It's awesome. Thank you that in the midst of despair, despondency, anxiety, angst, fear, doubt, you immediately say, don't let your heart be troubled. And then you punctuate it with strong words. Believe in God. Believe also in me. I pray for my friends that they would hold on. For those who are going through a rough patch right now, that they would believe you, Jesus, as being completely trustworthy. And that when things on earth ramp up, be the lifter of our head, as the psalmist said, and let us gaze at heaven. Thanks for the reminder for the child of God. That's home. That's home. Jesus, we thank you for these things in your powerful name, and God's people said, amen.
Lift our voice. Yeah.
Amen. Thank you so much for joining us today and worshiping the Lord with hope. Let's leave with confidence that He has saved us and that He has set us free. Hope to see you next week.